Washington County Attorney Pete Orput to provide public information about a multi-jurisdictional and multi-agency effort to uncover a human trafficking operation that is national and international in scope, with alleged criminal activity happening here regionally in Minnesota and in North Dakota. Criminal complaints have been filed in Washington County against four defendants, charging them with racketeering, sex trafficking, promotion of prostitution, concealing criminal proceeds in connection with a criminal enterprise profiting off of the sale of vulnerable human beings for sex. Investigators were able to connect this criminal enterprise to numerous victims and thousands, literally thousands, of ads for sexual services placed on Backpage.com in 29 different states over the past 2 years. The victims in this scheme were brutalized, frequently assaulted, raped, and robbed by customers, forced to work 12 to 14 hours per day, and forced to bring in a quota of at least $800 per day for their traffickers. One of the defendants is in custody in Washington County, and the remaining three defendants were apprehended yesterday in California and are now awaiting extradition to Minnesota. This joint prosecution is a product of police agencies in the metro area working together to uncover the facts of a criminal commercial enterprise that sold human beings for sex. All of our victims are vulnerable foreign nationals from Asia. The investigative effort in this case was extraordinary and included special police investigators from Oakdale, Woodbury, Cottage Grove, St. Paul, and Minneapolis, and the Washington County Sheriff's Office. In addition, this investigative effort was aided by law enforcement officials and prosecutors in Orange County, California. This effort began with and was led by Washington County Attorney Pete Orput and his dedicated staff in the Washington County Attorney's Office. My staff and I are honored to have been asked by Washington County to jointly prosecute this case with them. So as someone who has been deeply involved in the fight against sex trafficking in the state of Minnesota, I want to say that this is the most sophisticated human trafficking operation that I have ever seen. More importantly, this case represents the forward evolution of local law enforcement and prosecution response to human trafficking in the state of Minnesota. This sophisticated criminal enterprise was taken down by investigative cooperation and partnership, much like what we do in major drug trafficking cases, and by intentional choices by our local law enforcement leaders to make this issue a top priority. In other words, leadership. I want to thank all of the law enforcement agencies who are here today in attendance, because their work and their partnership and cooperation really mattered to bringing this day, to make this day possible. This level of leadership in our community is a precursor to more good things to come from local law enforcement and prosecution in combating human trafficking in our community. You know, we have come a really long way since February of 2011, when county attorneys and local law enforcement leaders announced a new victim-centered approach and a new focus on investigating traffickers and the buyers. Later that year, in 2011, in special session, the legislature passed the Safe Harbor Law. And then, on a bipartisan basis, our Minnesota legislature has been funding our Safe Harbor response to human trafficking. We have also, from the legislature, received appropriations for police training, protocol development, and also investigative grants. And that appropriation was what made this possible, because it allowed Washington County Attorney's Office to really lead the way on this new way of kind of investigating human trafficking. And so because of that grant, and because of the leadership of County Attorney Pete Orput, and all of the people here that you see here today. Those funds and those dollars are really making a difference. And so what we're doing as a state in Minnesota is we're building this infrastructure around responding to sex trafficking, human trafficking in our community. And as a society, we always will do that when we figure out what our problems are. But I know that everybody up here knows that we're not going to solve this issue solely by arresting and prosecuting. In fact, none of this happens unless there is a demand. And how we raise boys and how men define what is acceptable for men really matters. And so we really need to start talking also as a community about prevention, getting upstream, and also changing our culture with respect to the buying and selling of human beings. Now, with that, I would like to turn it over to Washington County Attorney Pete Orput, who, as I said before, is the reason why we're here today, and we'll talk about the facts that are mentioned in our probable cause statement. And we're just joined by Woodbury Chief Lee Vague as well. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, John, for those very generous remarks. In fact, I'd argue they're too generous. I became the county attorney in early 2011, and I immediately looked to John Choi's leadership in the area of sex trafficking, and I'm continuing to do this by asking him to give us a hand. I view the Ramsey County Attorney's Office as the true leader in the state. Let's get to the case, okay? The criminal complaint here, it's about 15 pages, and it details a sophisticated profit-making scheme. The operational control, we believe, was centered in Irvine, California, or other areas in Southern California. There, ads were placed on Backpage and other sites advertising women for rent for sexual purposes. Men would be given the address of the closest place. In other words, you could text in and they'd say, well, what part of the East Metro are you? Because we've got a number of locations. It seemed to me this was the Uber of sex trafficking, where you can get out your cell phone and you can order up a human being, and they'll find a convenient location for you to meet. The profit scheme was, in fact, renting out human beings. And my office has pored over thousands of these messages and text messages, and those responsible for doing this make it really clear that the women victims who are actually doing the sex work are nothing but property. That's how they're referred to by the hierarchy here. And the women who were involved in this disgusting work had one thing in common. They spoke little or no English. In addition, they move around all the time. And that's part of the scheme. These and several similar operations we've been involved in, they target women who don't speak English, who constantly move, so they can't develop ties. They have a hard time getting out when they're on the move, and they're handicapped by not speaking English. Once again, we view those victims as the vulnerable people in this profit-making scheme. I would also like to say that if there are criminal groups out there, and indeed there are, I want them to be warned. We're coming. The other thing I want to say is if you're a customer of these, please stop. This is not only criminal activity, but it's beyond immoral. And I thank you for your time, and I want to say one last thing. Doing this for about 32 years prosecuting, I've learned one thing. When we share and team up, I think we can make a big difference. I hope we're going to make a big difference today with this case. However, I will say it's still ongoing. We still have a number of things we're following up on, and there may indeed be more defendants coming. Thank you.
Okay, just a quick reminder, just remind us who you are, where you're from, and if there's a specific target of your question, let's do that. Reg, let's start with you.
Reg Chapman, WCCL TV. Mr. Choi, we talked a couple months ago. I thought Backpage was dismantled. I thought the escort service was non-existent anymore, that they complied with your request to not use that anymore. How are these people still using Backpage?
May I introduce Mr. Imran Ali from my office? Imran is the director of my major crimes prosecution unit. Imran spends his day along with a team of people that work for him, culling through Backpage. And I think if I could just ask him to explain a little bit about how we all heard about Backpage escort section was shut down, were it only true. Imran, would you mind just?
Yeah, from here? Or?
Right here.
Okay. So Backpage.com had an escort section, and that was shut down. And if you go on there now, you see it says censored. But what's happened is that that activity that was posted on the escort section actually moved to other areas of Backpage, like women seeking men seeking women, massage. And so what we're doing is we're actually tracking that data. And what we're seeing, and this is very early on, is that the numbers that we were looking at from the escort section are actually mirroring the same ads that are posted in women seeking men. So you take one away, you take one side of it away, and you move it somewhere else. And so that's, it's shut down, that one area, but is it still happening? Yes. Is it happening to the same, you know, level? Absolutely.
Susie Jones, WCCO Radio. What's the connection to Minnesota? Because it's centered in California, so where are the victims? Are they, is it all over the country? Kind of explain.
Well, they post ads. We've identified 29 municipalities. It seemed to us, based on the evidence, Minneapolis, St. Paul, Twin Cities area, and more specifically East Metro, is very popular with this group. They've put big investments in here. They bought real estate only for the use of sex trafficking. There's some money laundering activity going on in this state. Why Minnesota? I'm not sure. If they think it's because they can get away with it here, I hope I change that equation along with Mr. Choi.
Pete, can you talk about how you guys first came to identify the crime? Was it through a victim? Was it through a
no, no. Well, in this case, it was an informant told a Minneapolis police officer, a sex crimes detective, about an apartment in St. Louis Park. That led that officer to advise people who have made the commitment to do these, because not one department often has enough personnel. So our folks from East Metro got involved in going there, learned there were two Korean women there. Again, no speak English. They're, you know, getting moved around. They did not want to cooperate at the time. That's not unusual to us. But that led us then to start digging into the ads being placed. The ad for that apartment led us to a number of other ads, which led us to about close to 20,000 ads that were being placed as we were arresting these suspects. So we hope we're going to put an end to it, but we have a lot more work to do, Chow. Well, each area has, a regional boss, if you will. It's controlled by California. There's a regional boss here. The boss here was Dong Zhu Zhang, and he was in charge of picking up the women, taking them to the different sites, collecting all the money, getting them cases of condoms, cases of wet wipes, and kind of coordinating the logistics of running this kind of thing. You can imagine the logistics are fairly complicated when you've got a number of ads going at the same time for a number of locations in the East Metro Twin Cities. It takes a lot of work.
Where are they, Neil of Care 11, where are they finding these women? So like those two Korean women, how did they pick them up and then?
I could say we're working on that. We've got a lot more work to do. We wanted to announce this now because we think we've made big progress on this, but we do have a lot more questions to answer, and hopefully we'll have those. We would like to stop the entire pipeline for wherever it's coming. Right now, we have a lot of work to do.
So the Korean women, are they Minnesota residents, or were they Korean citizens and then?
Pardon me?
Nationals.
They were Korean nationals, as far as I know. We still, regardless, we viewed them as a victim. The problem is when they're adults, they have a choice. At the time, we tried to intervene and offer services. Many of them, I think, are greatly reluctant for a lot of reasons. We hope one goal here by getting this out is maybe some of those victims might say, well, now that the people in control are in jail, maybe now I can come forward. Or maybe someone else who's being trafficked comes forward. I'm hoping, I'm praying.
Let's get two more questions and then we'll finish up. Yep, and then
the Fox 9. So the victims in this case, none of them, they're all presumably still doing what they've been doing, or have they asked for help, or are any of them out of this?
Not as of today. As of today, we've offered help to a number of them, and we plan on persevering with that. And we think it'll make a difference that we've taken off some of the big players here so that people, if they have fear or they're afraid something bad's going to happen to them, you get all kinds of things when you're dealing with foreign nationals. They'll get threatened with deportation. They'll be threatened to be turned into ICE. It's a lot of different kinds of control. Understanding that means we have to really tap into our patience when we're dealing with these, in this case, young women. And we are patient, but we're not going to let go.
Let's finish up with
William Leffler, Rivertown Media. How much of this criminal activity was centered in Washington County?
Well, enough so to where there's a townhouse in Cottage Grove that was bought and paid for with cash, and when the police entered, they saw two beds. That's it. But they also saw a line of guys waiting on a couch, waiting for their turn. Sort of looks like the damn barber shop, doesn't it? Where you're waiting for your haircut. The business was so busy, there'd be people lining up waiting. It's that awful.
Were there any Johns arrested at all?
We're doing an ongoing investigation, Reggie. We did gather information from at least one. Whether we're going to prosecute him for that or not, we're in the midst of seeing where the direction of this investigation goes. Sometimes they might make a better witness than a perp. Although, like Mr. Choi said, the only way this is going to stop if we look at this thing in a more macro view of, well, how are we raising boys to men to do this? And I'm hoping by having this story out there, maybe somebody might reevaluate the risk-benefit involved. Right now, it seems so many men act this out because they figure the risk is very, very low. It's gotten to the point where they can pull out one of these, order a human being, and then order a pizza, and I'll bet the girl beats the pizza to their door. That's how awful it's become.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll be sending out the criminal complaints. We have hard copies for you here for all of you, and I'll be sending out an email really shortly. I also have a copy of our press release to kind of summarize a lot of this. And if you have any questions, feel free to follow them through. I'm sure there's plenty of folks who can help. Thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Next time, cookies and punch. Oh, that's right. Yeah.